HCAMP TV thanks you for watching this presentation. We'd love for you to become a member and use your creativity at our station. Please visit hinghammedia.org or call us at 781-836-5094 if you'd like to learn more.
I've put my canvas as close to her as possible because I can't see far anymore and I can't see close, which is kind of a problem, especially being an artist. So what I have to do is change my glasses. I can't use bifocals, it doesn't work. So right now I have my farsight glasses on, so I can see her really clearly, but I can't see my painting really clearly, which is good because you want to keep it mushy and soft for as long as possible. Then I'll start trading the glasses back and forth, and it's not fun. So look at just this paper towel is really doing a lot of work. And it doesn't really take much. Look at how pretty that's looking. So the paper towel is probably the most important tool in my toolbox. And so now, once I go back in here, now I've got my three values down, basically. I can start going into that. Okay. So I just added a little mineral spirits to this, just to lighten this up just a little bit more. Now I can start going back and forth. So I'm going to start, I have a smaller brush now. Let's see. I'm going to mix a nice flesh color. So I'm going to start, when I start with my lights, I like to start with a big glob of white and then add my three colors into it. When I start with my darks, I start with black and add my three colors. Now what Sergeant would like to do is, he has more yellow in the top of the head, more red in the middle of the head and more blue at the bottom of the head. The reason for that is because the middle of the face is so fleshy. So you see a lot of blood, you know, going through there. And the top of the head is very, you know, flat, and there's bone structure there and it's close to the light. So it's going to be more yellow, and then as the light recedes, you go with a little bit more of the blues. So I'm going to start my yellow ochre and my cad red medium and some white. And just see what color I have. You don't know what color you're mixing on your palette until you have it up here. And that color is perfect. So a lot of times, the way that I teach my painting is if you don't really know what you're doing and you just follow directions, you're going to end up with a pretty good start. All right, so here's those beautiful pinks. And you see, because I treated my board and toned it, the paint is sitting on it just so nicely. And this cloth and linen is such a pleasure to work on. All right, so now I'm going to add, and you can see I'm not worrying about really her details at this point. I'm just trying to fill my canvas in the first half hour. So that's very pink. Now I'm going to move over my puddle. I'm going to add more yellow in there, and that's very nice too. I love when a plan works here. So that is my yellows. You can see the value is the same. When you can't see where one color ends and the other begins, it means it's the same value. So I'm really trying to keep just one value in her light areas at this point. And I'm squinting. Okay, so now I'm gonna add a little, now I'm moving over. So every time I make a new color, I like to make a new puddle also, just so I have more colors to choose from later. So when I look down at these puddles, I can see if the value is close or not. So all these three colors are the same value, but this is my bluer, this is my redder, and this is my yellower, the three colors on the three primary colors on the color wheel. So that's very, very blue, but I like it, so I'm going to keep going. I'd rather start off too bright, too thick, and too dark than opposite, because those are easier to fix. So again, I'm exaggerating this color for your benefit. Okay, a lot of times you'll see all those three values in the neck. What happens is the room radiates back into the neck, and it's more warm than anything, but she has that cool purple collar around her, so I'm seeing a lot of blue in there. All right, so it's almost done, huh? Okay, so now I've got those three values in there. The three colors in that one value in the light, I have the shadow value and I have the dark value. What Sargent would do is have three values in the lights and two in the dark. So the dark would be your dark and then your shadow. And in your lights, you have your lights. Then you have your highlights, which are a little bit lighter than the lights. Again, I'm squinting. And what I like to do with the eyes, I like to draw the socket in there and then draw the lights into that. So the sockets are very dark, and once I start doing this here, I can pull the eye out rather than to draw it like a coloring book. Okay. And I'm not attacking my painting at any point, but I'm not trying to be too careful either. So these are my highlights, a little bit of light on the chin, a little bit on the nose. And a little on the cheeks in here. Okay. So that's two values. So my third value is going to be the lights on the dark side of the face, which are a little bit darker than the lights on the light side of the face because it's surrounded by dark, so that dark is kind of diffusing its way into those lights, making it appear a little bit darker. So I'm just going to make this just a little bit darker. Squinting. And because of my time limit, I'm going to try to be a little more accurate than I would if I was on my own painting with plenty of time. All right. So now I have my three values in the lights and three values in the shadows. So this is a great time to take my Viva paper towel.
What?
Viva.
Viva.
Oh, feel the difference. This is very soft and absorbent, and it doesn't have any pattern on it. Okay. So this doesn't do what that does, and that doesn't do what this does. This is stronger while still being soft, and this is soft without having all that detail in there. So what I like to do at this point is to put this over my painting, because you can't fix mistakes once they get too thick. So what I'm doing is I'm taking off the extra paint, and I'm softening my edges at the same time, and I'm not ruining my painting at all. Okay, this is what Richard Schmid would do also to kind of soften this painting. Okay, and that's really all I'll use the Viva for. If I try to use it like the Bounty, I'll leave pieces of it behind, and that's never a good thing. Okay, so now I'm going to start from my darks and work into my lights, and I'm going to start repairing. Okay, usually the darkest part of the face is underneath the eyebrow on the dark side of the face. Yeah, so I'm just darkening that in. At this point, I'm still playing. My first hour, I like to fill the canvas and make it look pretty accurate. The second hour, I play, and then the third hour, I finish. So this is play time. Because what makes a painting magical is not that it looks like a photograph, but that you have some really interesting happy accidents going. And if you don't allow yourself to play, you're not going to get those happy accidents in there. So generally, when it comes to the mouth, the only sharp edges that you should see should be on the corners of the mouth. All right. I'm still squinting. I might even take my glasses off now. So I get that blur in both places. Okay, now I'm going to go into my shadows because there's not a heck of a lot of dark in her face, just in her hair. So that's too dark. So if you have a color and you mix it and it's the wrong color, don't keep going. Stop what you're doing and either try to put it in another spot or make the color right. What I like to do is to see if I can use it anywhere else before I put it down. That keeps me moving all around my painting in a very disciplined way. But I know that's just a little bit too dark. So I'm adding a little bit more white, but I'm also adding a little bit more yellow and red to that to keep it warm. So I'm just going in here. And this I can use. What I love to do is to blend on my palette. So that's why I like to make it a little darker and brighter than it actually is, so I can have that fun of blending on the palette. That's really a lot of fun. You comfortable up there?
Yeah.
So also when I paint, do a portrait, I like to have a little bit of a smile on it. So once I get all the features in and it starts to look like the people, I do engage them a little bit. Because I don't want somebody that looks tired or angry up there. I do like the smile. And that's kind of the magic of doing a portrait as well, is not so much of getting the look, but you want the personality in there as well. Now, a lot of times when people do a painting of a head, they bring the nose all the way down to here without thinking of this beautiful shadow that's between the tip of their nose and underneath there. Very, very common with students to paint that nose, all that light of the nose all the way down to the bottom. But she has a beautiful shadow under there. I'm squinting, squinting, squinting. I'm trying not to finish one thing before I get to the next thing. I'm just trying to have this all feel like you're in a shower. You just come out of the shower and your mirror is all foggy, and it's as the steam fades away, you start to see yourself more clearly. So I don't want it to look perfect too soon. So I'm still keeping it soft. The brushes I'm using nowadays are the Silver Bristlon. I used to only use the Winsor & Newton Lexington series, but I've just discovered these Silver Bristlon brushes that are so good. And you can't beat them up. They just stay sharp and to the point. And they're not that much more expensive. You have to choose your supplies like you'd choose a weapon in a fight, Richard Schmid would say. And you know, if you use a crappy brush, you're just fighting against that brush. So you want a good brush that does what it's told. So you can really start to see this forming now. Now I have this beautiful color on my brush. I want to see if it works in her hair. Not really. I do see some of it down here. Hair is more golden than that. So now I'm going to take my mahl stick and use my mahl stick because I want to start getting a little bit more in detail so it keeps my hand steady. This is just a doll I get at Walmart for 50 cents. I lost my awesome stick that came apart. Lost my mirror. I'm losing my head. Here. All right. So now I'm going to put in, you always want to put in the highlights as soon as possible. You can take them out and put them back in, but they really help you to measure. So you want to put them in so I can really see the highlights in her eyes. So I really want to do that. Okay, so I'm just going to switch glasses to see how I'm doing. Ah, it's so great having bad eyesight sometimes, because you really see things like you want the viewer to see things with less vision. So as I go around and repairing, I'm also trying to keep my edges soft. There's no hard lines in the face, especially with pretty young girls. They're very, very soft. Okay. So now the face is close enough, so what isn't close is her shirt and the background. So before I go into any more detail, I'm going to put the background in. And in general with the face, because it's so warm, you like to have a cool background in there. So I see a lot of, where our face is so reddish pink, I see a lot of blue, bluish green in the background. So it's the complementary color on the cooler side. So complements are two colors that are opposite each other on the color wheel. And so I see a lot of orangey red in here. I'm going to put a little bit of greenish blue back there just to, for variety. Okay, and you can see that I'm kind of fixing my drawing as I go along. My paintings tend to need a haircut at some point. I give them too much hair. So now I want to see where her shoulders come. Her right shoulder is lower than her left shoulder, and her left shoulder comes about this far below the chin. So now I know exactly where that goes. And double check everything you do. Don't assume it's right. Go back and check it. Compare, compare, compare. All right, so now I'm going to go into the shirt. And you can see, because I have a lot of brushes going on, I can simply use them almost like crayons with different colors. So now I'm going into my full palette here. I'm going into my cool blue and red to make that purple. So anytime I see this purple in the shadow, I'm going to use this cool blue and red. And anytime I see the purple in the light, I'm going to go to my warm blue and red. I'm going to keep it on the red side, though, because her face is very red. So I want to keep it in harmony, reddish orange. And because the value is red, I can use this color in her hair and not worry too much about it. Hey! All right. So that looks good. So now I'll go into my cerulean blue and cad red medium, which is my warm red and blue. And I'm going to go into the light colors of that shirt now. Add a little white that's too dark. That's feeling better, but I see some yellow in there too. So I'm going to go in with my cad yellow deep. And that's close enough for now. Now I tend to make my models look like linebackers at first, so I have to remind myself to go in there and soften that up. Now, another thing I forgot is my little cup for my medium. So I'm using the cover here, so I ran out pretty fast. So now I'm going to take a little of my medium into my paper towel and just move this around really nice. Look how great that is. Look how much fun that is. Okay, I'm not being too accurate yet. I'm going to do that with her hair a little bit more too. This is with my Bounty, not the Viva. Okay. And this is, I still have time to play, so this is what I'm doing. I'm still playing. Plus, I love to have the audience go, what the heck is she doing? All right. So I'm just going to go in. Now that I have all my relationships right, I have the background in, I have her shirt in, I have her hair. Now I can really see what needs to be done. I'm a little bit too pink in the face, but that's very easy to fix. So the opposite of pink is my cerulean blue, so if I add a little of that color in, it's going to dull it quite nicely. You see, I know you guys are going, oh, I wish she put her eyes in. And the eyes are really the center of interest when you're doing a portrait, but again, I want to keep this extra loose for a little bit longer, just for your benefit here. So now I can go back into this. I've used paper towel, so I've got everything very thin. It's very easy to work over. So now I can start laying in some of the finish. I'm going to start working a little bit harder of bringing this out of a fog. So I'm going to start with the eyes because the eyes really are the center of interest in here. You can see it's so much easier to pull this light out of the dark than it is to draw it like a coloring book. And that's my goal here. I'm still not too concerned at this point because I have enough time to make it look like her, but I'm still searching for those happy accidents. And I'm softening as much as I can. Now the light is coming from the right-hand side. I generally like to have the light on the left-hand side because that's how we read from left to right. But in this case here, I do have it on the right-hand side. So as I'm repairing some of my colors, I'm also trying to repair my drawing. Now when I have a color on my brush, it's really important, especially with the portrait, to use it everywhere before you put it down because it really forces you to work all around the painting and to use that color as much as possible. Right now there's a lot of warmth in her face, so I'm going to be searching out those cool areas soon. But what I'm doing is I'm asking myself, what's the worst thing in the painting? And I'm going to work on that until it's no longer the worst thing. Not that I have to finish it, but I just don't want it to be the worst thing anymore. Once I do that, then the next thing that's bad pops out. And at first I have big mistakes, and then my mistakes get smaller and smaller as I go along. Now anything on the light side of the face has to be a little bit lighter than anything on the dark side of the face. So she has brown eyes, so the brown eye on this side has to be a little bit darker than the brown eye on the other side because it's surrounded by light over here, and that light is working its way into those darks as well as the darks working its way into the lights over here. Squinting. I can hear the thoughts in your heads going, she's finally starting to make it look a little more like her. Yeah. But you see how I really depend on this mall stick? Because if I was to do this, my hand would be all over the place. The mall stick is really helping me to keep my hand steady. And by having what I like to do is have a light, a medium, and a dark brush so I can keep going back and forth between them as I move along. So at first my brushes are big and then my brushes get smaller. Now I'm going to use my other glasses to see my painting a little bit better. Squinting, or with my eyes, all I have to do is look at her without my glasses on. Now, it's important, you know, if you're going to be a good portrait artist, you really need to paint the portrait often. You're not going to do a great job every time, but there's so much to remember that if you only paint the portrait every once in a while, you're not going to remember all those really important things that, you know, when you paint every day becomes innate. So you really do have to practice. And there's no shortcuts. There are no shortcuts. You have to work at this. So you see, I'm really working all the way around the head here. And as I keep going, repairing. Still, knowing that I have enough time, I'm not too worried yet. There does come a time where I begin to panic. But not yet. My 17 years of bartending has helped me get through that. Rush hour. One more drink, just one drink at a time. One stroke at a time. But we're getting there. Now, when it comes to the eyes, too, a lot of times these bottom eyelids are pretty important. So now that I'm painting, been painting a while, because painting the portrait is the hardest thing you can do, you get tired very quickly, so you have to start relying on other tools, like putting the cup over your eye like this takes away a lot of the ambient light. And I squint and I jiggle my eyes back and forth. That's one way. Another way is using the mirror. So at the last hour of my painting, I only look really through my mirror because I'm so tired. I don't want to paint what I know. I want to paint what I see. And you have to be really disciplined in order to do that. Now, when I'm painting the eye, I'm not looking directly into the eye. I'm looking at, say, her nose and bringing my eye back to that eye, or her ear or her head. And that's another very difficult, important thing that you have to do as an artist. Because when you look directly at something, you're seeing the pieces. You're not seeing the relationship of that next to something else. So by looking away and seeing what that eye is in relation to the nose, I'm going to be more apt to paint the whole face rather than just the pieces, and they'll connect together, which is really, 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 really difficult to do. And, you know, even after painting for as long as I have, I still have to force myself to do it. Now, you notice, too, that the face is life-size or smaller. You never want to paint the face larger than life-size. It just looks, it doesn't look right. My teacher, Robert Cormier, would say it looks gorilla-like. So unless you have a good reason, try not to make the painting larger than life-size. So I'm really squinting right now, hard, jiggling my eye back and forth, trying to look all around the painting and not in one spot. Now, if anyone has any questions, feel free to ask. Hopefully around Mother's Day, we'll be doing our portrait, half-hour portrait thing again. So start getting your requests in.
Can you tell what that is about? Dianne will paint live from what is sitting here. And it's $200 in 45 minutes. And then you go home and
paint. It's fun, too. And it's great for young kids because they can't sit still that long. So, you know, I knock it out pretty quickly. I don't really work as tightly as I am right now. But they're fun, energetic paintings, I think.
I wonder if Kristen wants to stretch, because it's been an hour.
Has it been an hour already? See, I'm a slave driver. Let's take a break. Let's take a break. So if anyone has any questions, you're welcome. Take a walk around and stretch your legs out. Because even sitting sometimes gets tiring after a while. So you can see right now it's about halfway down. I'm kind of happy with it. So a lot of times when I'm doing a portrait and I don't want to stop, what I could do is work on the background, work on the shirt, and things like that.
Can you start again by telling the color that you used initially for the background?
Okay. So basically I have the color wheel, which is a subdued version.
Right.
Okay. So in the face is very, very warm. So I only have, you think like in your primary colors, blue, red, and yellow. Red and yellow are warm colors, and blue is a cool color. So this has more of my cool color back there. And of course, white cools down things as well. So that's giving me that nice contrast of the face, the warm face next to the cool background. Does that make sense?
Yes. So you use what?
So I use my cerulean blue, or I could even use black.
Okay, yeah. And okay. That gave you that. For me, now it looks brownish in the back.
Well, that's because I started with that brown. I used the flesh tone just to tone my board. So that's kind of working on top of that. Yeah. So you're seeing pieces of the color, which is very exciting to the viewer as well. So that's another reason I like to tone my boards, is because a lot of times that color is going to peek through. Now you have two colors up there instead of one, and a lot of that's going to show through. And not only that, but students tend to paint on the cool side. So by starting with a beautiful warm color first, you're getting a lot of that warmth in your painting without any effort at all. Good question. Anybody else?
I just have a comment. When you added a little dark, I'll call it a dot from here, to when you're looking at this, the left side of her mouth, it literally made her look instantly like she had a little smile.
Yeah. Well, towards the end, I'll probably talk to her a little bit and try to incorporate a little bit of that smile into the painting. But at the time, I need her to, you know, sit still and try to get it right, and then I change it afterwards.
I just found that amazing.
It's fun to watch. It really is, you know, and that's why I think, you know, coming to a demo, sometimes you learn more than if you're in a class, because you get to see it being done. Mm. And in my classes, I always like to do a demo first, because it takes away a lot of that mystery, like, what am I going to do? How do I start?
Right.
And in my case, I start the same way all the time, starting with my darks and working into my lights, not trying to make it perfect at first, but, you know, trying to work into that perfection.
And your students aren't intimidated?
All my students are divas by the time I'm done with them.
Right,
Kate? So, yeah, don't be afraid. My class is so much fun, too. And I really, like, as I'm explaining now, I really try to explain it in a layman way. And if you don't understand what I'm saying, I try to say it in another way so you will understand, or I'll show you. And a lot of times, showing is the best. So if a teacher says, oh, let me show you on your canvas, and you say, no, don't touch my painting, let them touch it, because that's how you learn. I couldn't wait for my teacher to touch my painting, because that's when I learned the most. Because we're visual learners, we learn by seeing, and sometimes the words just don't make sense. Mm-hmm. Do you want to try it again? What do you think so far?
I like it.
So you can see here, I have kind of a sharp edge, and you can see how it's not great. You know, the face is round, so I'm going to fix that. Janie, I missed you. I was wondering where you've been. She went to Italy with me last year. I haven't seen her since. All right, so when you start a painting, you shouldn't just jump into it. You've got to analyze it and ask yourself what you've done right and what you've done wrong. So by using a mirror, it tells me exactly what I've done wrong, because it's switching the view, so I'm seeing it with a fresh eye right away. So the mirror, once you get tired, is priceless, and I can already see a lot of the stuff that I've done wrong. That's the first thing I'm going to do. What's the worst thing in the painting? Well, the face is too wide. And that's something that I typically do every time I paint. And we all do that. We all have something that we do wrong every time. So if you paint all the time, you are aware of it, so you compensate by going in the opposite direction. So I tend to paint a little bit wider, and I give them a little bit too much hair. So what I'm doing is I'm seeing both her and my painting in the same view in the mirror. So I'm just jiggling my eye back and forth. So when you do this, when you're painting, you lose so much information in that split second. But here I can see it right next to each other. So my comparing is much, much, much easier. You can see that looks better already. All right. That looks 100 times better. Now, which glasses do I want to wear? This is embarrassing, but I will be doing this at some point, too.
You need to get too late.
I do. I just had my eyes diagnosed, so I haven't had a chance to get new glasses yet.
No,
so
I need one of those dinghies, so the longer it's the show.
It's pretty embarrassing, but you do what you have to do, right?
Yeah.
The problem is the comparing part. So when I look in the mirror, I'm looking at the same plane. So it's easy for me to use my glasses and compare. But when I'm looking at this and that, they're two different planes, so it's hard for me to compare. And that's a real problem that I'm having right now. When I turned 45, I lost my near sight. And now I'm losing my far, and it's just, I have to figure it out. When I lost my near, it was great because I saw blurrier on my painting, so I painted it that way. And that's how you want to begin. You don't want to start too accurately. But now with both the sight going, it's horrible.
Not if you're 46.
Right. Oh, I wish. All right, so right now I've fixed the side of her face, I fixed her eye. So other things that are wrong are starting to pop out. At first your mistakes are big, and then your mistakes get smaller, hopefully. This is such a nice light on people. They do have a new light, though, that I want to invest in, where it's flat, and you can turn it warm to cool, and you can dim it. But I haven't invested in that yet either. This is the light that Richard Schmid uses. And in my opinion, he's just simply one of the best in every way. My teachers were Robert Douglas Hunter and Robert Cormier, who were from the Boston School, which is a very academic way of learning how to paint. And I was in an atelier for 5 years, full-time year-round. And they taught you one thing at a time. So at first you learned how to draw, then you learned how to draw values, then you learned how to draw with color, then you learned how to paint, and you first did things that didn't move, and then you went into figure. So it was a very complete way of learning how to paint. And in the early 1900s, if you were accepted into an atelier, you came out a superstar. That's because people thought more of artists way back then. It was a job. Now they think we're just having fun and it's a blast, but they don't understand all the work that's involved. And where I've been painting for over 30 years, I've really come to see why it takes a lifetime to learn how to paint. And I look back at some of the work that I did when I was in my 20s, and it's sometimes better than what I've done now, but there's more depth into my work now. One of my other models over here coming in. I wish I knew you were coming, I would have brought it. All right. So yeah, Robert Douglas Hunter, Robert Cormier, Bob Moore, Dave Lowry, wonderful, wonderful artists and teachers. Dave Lowry is the only one that's left now. The rest are gone. See, once I really started to take that face in, now I see I also need to give her a haircut. And now you can see she's really, it's really becoming life-size now as well. All right, so I'm going to nail those eyes right now so I can move on. I'm squinting. If my life depended on it. So I'm just taking, you know, baby steps, and, you know, as I'm putting these things in, I'm looking around. Now the nostril on the right-hand side of the face, on the light side, shouldn't, it's dark, but it shouldn't be black. It's very, you can see the blood flowing through there, so you want to keep it very, very warm. Now with women, you don't have to paint everything, especially for us more mature women. Sometimes less is more. So what I like to do with an older woman is to paint in everything and then edit to see what I need for the personality. If I don't need a line or grab a bit of wrinkle, I'll get rid of it. I know I had a friend that was in her 80s and we were doing those quick portraits, and this is not the best place in the world to be a portrait artist. People are like, what do I want a picture of myself for? Whereas if you're down south or up in Canada, you're a rock star if you're a portrait painter. And you're nobody until you have a portrait of yourself over your mantle. And so, you know, getting people to sit is like pulling teeth almost. There we go. Look at this. This is starting to come out. I always go through this phase where I get excited and it's coming out good, and then of course then I go into despair because then I ruin it. It's definitely a perseverance thing you have to have. All right, so we're getting there. We're getting closer. So basically what I'm doing now is I'm just moving my paint around on my canvas. So if you're a very stingy artist with your paint, you're not going to have this wonderful paint to move around because it's just going to be scratching. So anytime I hear scratching, I take out my mall stick and I beat my students until they use more paint. Right, Fran? So I lost my mall stick. I wonder if it was stolen or if I actually lost it. All right, so here we're getting softer, we're getting closer. There. And sometimes it just takes one stroke to finish a painting. So at this point, you have to be very, very much aware of what you're doing. So when you've done something right, you want to leave it also. So once I have it exact, which I'm getting to that point, then I like to take out my big brushes and start trying to loosen it up. And I'll also start adding, I'll look at my palette and I'll say, all right, what color haven't I touched? And I'll try to move that around. So right now it's a very warm painting, so I'm going to go in with my cool colors and see where I can inject some of that color. I still have my three brushes going, one in the dark, one in the light, and one medium. So I can simply go back and forth. All right, so now I'm going to put a little more blue out. I'm going to start exaggerating my color so I can come to see it. A lot of times the students don't see it, but then the trick for that is to exaggerate it. So I'm going to take this blue. And what's happening is I'm seeing the color, I'm feeling the color, I'm not necessarily seeing it. So it's almost like an aura of the color. So I'm going to show you exactly where I see these auras. And that's too dark. So I'm exaggerating this color right now. I'm trying to get in some of these cool colors. If you want variety, you can really see it right there. It's a very blue light that's hitting her face. So I really want to seek out these colors. Can you do me a favor? Can you sit back in your chair just a little bit more? Perfect, thank you. And models move. You can't, they're breathing, they're moving. You have to deal with that as an artist. You know, usually if a model is moving or they're not looking where you want them to, I just work somewhere else until they go back to it, which they usually do. So in May, I'm going to Spain. I'm taking a group out there to paint. And last year, I went to Cinque Terre, and we took Jane and Fran. It was wonderful. So next year, we'll probably go back to Italy. So if you're ever thinking about something like that, it's a blast. And we paint as much or as little as you want. I paint every day, and you can pick times that you want to sightsee or paint. It's all up to you. It's always a good time. Now the lip, the bottom lip is generally, there's places that are generally in shadow when you paint, especially like I like to have the light at 10 o'clock. It's very attractive. So underneath the eyes, underneath the eyebrows, underneath the eyes, underneath the nose, the upper lip, and the bottom lip are generally places that have a little bit more shadow. So you want to look for those. Now when it comes to the eye, what you see with the eye is just a big circle, a ball, and then here's the pupil and the iris here, and the lid is coming over it. So the light is coming from this direction. So in general, the highlight is going to be here, and the color of the eye is going to be here, opposite that. The rest is basically in shadow and a little bit darker. So if you have somebody with blue eyes, you don't paint that whole part blue. You want to, you know, leave a spot for the color and the highlight in there, and the rest is kind of under shadow here. So the light's coming from this direction. Then you see that black mark in the middle. And, you know, you want to keep the eyes kind of soft too. You don't want to have that line like a photograph would take it. So, and this side is going to be lighter than this. So this, she doesn't have the whites of her eyes. It's the gray or the blue or pink or whatever color that ends up being. So one side of the eye is lighter than the other side. And once you get the highlight in, not everybody has highlights because some have deep set eyes. Once you have that in, then they start looking human. And you want to be careful about them too. You want one to be just a little bit bigger than the other. And you don't want them too big because then it looks like they're on drugs or they're ready to cry. All right. So now I put my glasses so I can see clearer in my painting, because I'm going to go into the finishing stages now, and I want to see her on the softer side. So now it's getting to be panic time. Do you need another break?
No, I'm good.
Okay. So I'm still working that blue around too. I see some over here. See some in the nose as it recedes. I see a lot of it in the hair. And I want to continue to soften. Now I have to stop playing and make some decisions. I have to get serious. And this is the hardest part, because now you're tired, the model is tired, and you want it to look good. So you have to work harder. It doesn't get easier. It's like exercising. It never gets easy. The more you know, the harder it gets. And perseverance is the most important tool in an artist's toolbox. More important than talent or anything, because talent is what happens after you put all the work in. But there's so many components that equal success as an artist, and talent is probably the least of them. Perseverance, drive, ambition, luck. Those things are all part of the big picture. Drive, I mean, you know, for me, I'm poor, so I'm driven to sell, which makes me paint more. My teacher used to say the best artists are starving artists, because you don't sit still. You have to keep painting because you have to make, you know, your bread. So, you know, it's a blessing in disguise that I'm poor, because I'm lazy too, so it makes me work harder. And as you know, I'm probably one of the hardest working artists you'll ever meet. So I had a show last night in Marion, which I brought 62 paintings there.
Wow.
And I'm, you know, this is the paintings in this show were all done in the last year. So I go out painting a lot. Most of the small paintings were done on location, and all the larger paintings were done from paintings that I did on location. So I'll use my sketchy and the photo to finish them. And the paintings that were in Marion, I like to call the best of the rest. So it was really quite exciting for me to see all my paintings up on walls that I've done a long time ago that I've kind of put away, as well as coming back in here and seeing all my new fresh things. It's pretty exciting. But I've been very lucky too. What I like to do is trade a painting for somebody's cottage or home. And this year I was quite lucky. I had a place in Eastham for 2 weeks, and then I also had a place at Pocasset for a week. So I was 3 weeks down the Cape, and then I go to Nantucket for a week, and I also went to Italy. So I was away quite a bit this year and painting. Yeah, that's one of the benefits of being an artist. So this year I was in Florida, and then I'm going to Spain. And when I come back from Spain, I'll be going to Nantucket. And then I'm having a couple big shows up north this year. In July, I was invited to a national show at the Agassiz Village, the Agassiz Gallery in Bar Harbor. And with all the top leading artists from all over the country. So that is hugely exciting for me. So I have to, one of the requirements is that you have to be there, go there 3 times to paint. So I'll be heading up there, and then I'm having a show of it at the Bryan Memorial Art Gallery in Jeffersonville, also in July. Is that in July or is that in August? And last year they had a show of all Robert Douglas Hunter's work, who was one of my teachers. And then this year they're taking each one of his students, and they're going to have their work displayed as well as the students. So a lot of my students will be having work in there as well.
Where is that one?
That's in Jeffersonville, Vermont, which is almost all the way up to Canada. Oh, yeah. So,
half hour.
Is it? Yeah. That's it? So I'm really looking forward to that, so you'll have to come.
Okay. And you can live in Rocheport for the summer, I told you.
Oh, yes, and I have another donor here. Will hopefully be a student in the future.
Do you have a favorite place to paint out of those?
As long as I'm outdoors, I'm happy. Seriously. But for me, painting the face is, or the nude also, is my favorite thing to do. It's more difficult, but I just love painting people. But it, like I said, around here, it's really the worst place in the world to be a portrait artist because people don't want portraits of themselves on their walls for some strange reason.
I think my husband would love it.
Yes. I think he would too. Let's make a date.
Yeah, let's do that.
All right, so it's really starting to look good now. Let's get rid of this. Like somebody was watching me. Yeah. And now I'm going to work into her hair a little bit more. So when you paint, too, you don't want to look around the corner. I just caught myself doing that. So I'm just going to move over just a little bit. You want to be able to just jiggle your eye back and forth. Don't forget to look in your mirror. The mirror is so important, especially at the end, because you're so tired at this point. You really need to stay focused. I'm squinting. Now, if you don't paint the hair until the very end, it's not good because then you're not getting your relationships right. Now, at this point, too, what I like to do is when I make the painting, I try to make it as finished looking as possible, and then I'll go in with my big brush and try to loosen it or start making strokes that are going to be a little bit more exciting. So I'm thinking about the planes of the head. I'm thinking about maybe some extra color, softening, all those things. Because it's not just making the painting look like the person, but it's so much more. It's about the strokes that you put down. It's about how you put the paint down, the colors that you use, what you're trying to say. I just want to play with them. He's so pretty. So you see, I'm still giving her a haircut after all this. But again, I remember that I have to do that. So I'm reminding myself to do it. Does anyone have any questions? I use mainly Rembrandt and Winsor Newton. If I had my choice, I'd use Rembrandt. It's the best, cheapest quality paint. There's so many good paints out there now. I just don't use Grum Kaka. No. Grumbaka. And don't use the Winton unless you know what you're doing. If you're a student, don't start with the Wintons. You can end up with the Wintons, but don't start with the Wintons. The Wintons have less pigment in them, less color, so you're using more paint. So you're not saving anything. They say it's for students. I would prefer my students to start off with good quality paint because it helps to do good quality paintings. And that's the first thing they buy because paints are so expensive.
They go to Michael's.
And then they go to Michael's and nothing's there. Just get it online and use your coupons and compare prices too, because this is expensive. So right now I'm adding just a little bit of extra color just so I can see it. Again, I don't really see it this bright, but I love to exaggerate my color at some point so I can start to see it. Now generally when I do a portrait, I like to have at least 3 hours. Anything more than 3 hours and you're just too tired to do anything good in that last hour. Right now we basically have 2 hours. But 3 hours is much, much better. And you can almost see why with the state of this portrait. So as I'm working down the face, I'm adding just a little bit of my cerulean blue just to dull it down just a little bit. But I like the color. I'm not afraid of color. I'd rather see too much color than not enough. The mouth is something you want to keep very, very soft, though. Almost like it's going to begin talking, is what Sargent would say. So right now my mistakes are getting smaller. At this point now, you don't want to attack your painting anymore. You want to go slow and compare. You can see, you know, as my edges get, everything gets softer and more finished. If it's not soft, it really pops out. And for me, a lot of times my last part of the face is in the shadow part of the face, in the cheek. It's something I always do. Don't ask me why, it's just you know, how it turns out. So I have to remind myself, because that's where I'm at my most tired, is at the end, to really make sure I'm doing a good job. And a lot of times, too, when you paint, you know something is hard or something is wrong and you don't want to change it because you know it's going to be hard. And you put it off and put it off and put it off. Just do it. That's my favorite quote. Just do it. Because if you put it off, you're not working in discipline. You just got to do it. Like, I see that her mouth was a little bit too low. And I don't want to fix it because it's going to be a lot of work. So I put it off. And you don't want to do that. You just want to do it. Just do it. And what happens is, when you just do it, you go, oh, that didn't take so much work. That didn't take so long. And now you've got a nice painting. So a lot of what I teach in my class is discipline. If you do it all the time, then you don't have to remember a lot of what you're doing because it becomes habit. And that's what you want. You want your brain to be open to do the more difficult things. So by doing things the same way each time in a very orderly and disciplined fashion, you're going to allow yourself to have more time to do even the harder stuff, because this never ever gets easy. Almost there. I have some things.
Do you find painting people harder or easier than landscapes?
Oh, it's way harder.
Way harder.
Without a doubt. Because if you paint a tree wrong, nobody's going to know. But if you paint that nose wrong, you know, it's not going to look like the model. And the model is, you know, it's the details are small and they're moving and breathing. But for me, the nude is even more fun because then you have the figure in there as well. But again, we're not in a great place where these paintings sell. I may move to Atlanta one of these days. So a lot of things I might have left because I know I'm going to get back to them, but I want to keep it soft. And as I'm finishing it, you can see almost the method of my madness, of why I did what I did. Again, I want to keep it soft. So by using big brushes, that it's really a helpful way of keeping your edges soft. So don't be afraid of the big brushes. Now, if you go home and you feel like you need a nap, it's because you have been given so much information, really. And a lot of times when I teach, you're able to grasp this and that, a little bit of this and a little bit of that, but you can't hear it all. There's just too much information that's just been passed around. So that's why, taking a class is good because you're getting it a little by little. And that's how we learn things, the repetition, yeah. And I had a student that one time said, oh, geez, you never said that before. I'm like, I say it every single class. You're just ready to hear it today. And we all learn at different speeds and levels. And I just repeat myself over and over and over. And that's how you learn. You see how nice that paper towel is doing? You don't want to paint every string of the hair. Then it looks like spaghetti. You want to keep it soft and flowing. And that's the magic of the paper towel. That you just can't get with a brush even. I'm keeping my paint nice and thin in the darks. I'm keeping my hair soft. Look how pretty that looks. And then you just go in there and draw one or two strands and it's like magic. So I teach every morning, Mondays and Tuesdays at the South Shore Art Center. Mondays is an outdoor class once it starts getting nice. And we paint all around Cohasset, which is gorgeous. So much to paint. Wednesdays, I'm starting a class on March 29th. And that'll be outdoors if it's above 40s and not windy. And indoors doing the still life if it is. Great area to paint again, and a great group of people that take the class. On Thursdays, I have something at my house where you can finish a still life. So I leave the still lifes up, and you can work on them for as long as you want until they're finished. Because in the classroom, you're constantly starting new paintings because I have to take them down after 3 hours. But at my house, you can learn how to finish, which is really great. And then on Fridays, I paint the figure, clothed and nude, and that's at the North River Art Association. And there's a room in there if you want to join. And that's a blast, and then we go outside when it's nice. So we paint the figure outside. That class is my favorite class because we're painting the figure. And you can, if you're a friend of mine on Facebook, you can see what I do because I post everything up there. So if you're not on Facebook, I encourage you to be on Facebook because there's so much good artwork out there. And there's so much information that you're missing if you're afraid of Facebook. So right now I'm thinking about the direction of the planes of her head when I'm putting in my brush strokes and doing my finishing. I want to sculpt her face almost now. So I'm thinking about the size and the direction of my brushstrokes as well as trying to finish it. Again, I'm using a big brush. I don't have my small brushes. So if anyone out there wants a portrait done, just call Kate and we can arrange it. We can do it at your house, we could do it at my house, or we could do it here. But you should have it done. Everybody should have a portrait of themselves or their kids. I am the cheapest plastic surgeon you'll ever, ever meet. Well, what I was trying to say earlier, too, is I had this woman, we were doing the half-hour sketches, and she didn't want to have it done. We talked her into it. She was 80 years old. She was a beautiful lady. I don't know if you remember her. And we ended up doing it. I did an awesome job. She was thrilled with the painting. And then she had a stroke a week later. So she had this beautiful painting of herself, you know, that she forced herself to do, and now her family has something beautiful to remember her by. So, you know, every face is beautiful, in my opinion. Every face. And, No. I edit. I edit.
She doesn't paint every wrinkle.
Oh, well.
Well,
we're not real, right?
Well, I get what you need to say, tell the story. I mean, we all have a story to tell with our faces. So I get what we need, hopefully. So now I'm going into some of my cooler color in here. You can see I have a very light touch because I want to keep it really, really soft at this point. Look how pretty she is. You see, I didn't go into that detail until the very end. I painted the cake before I put the frosting on. And that is really hard to do. And that's not how we want to paint. We have cameras now, so we want to paint like a camera sees things. And that's not how you want to paint, like the viewer sees things, not like the camera sees things. And the eye can only focus on one thing at a time. So you can't have perfect drawing and lines everywhere. You have to figure out how you want to lead the viewer into the painting and direct them around so they become engulfed in the painting and they can't leave without the painting. They have to go home with it because they just can't find their way out. And that's our goal.
And you want to know it's a painting, not a photograph.
Yeah, if you paint every single detail of the painting, they're going to go, wow, that's really nice, and walk away. It's like, or if you paint too much detail, then they're going to get a headache. So you have to find that variety of enough, that nice variety. You want a lot of color and a little color. You want a lot thick paint and you want thin paint. And you don't want the same exact amount of either. Variety is the spice of life. So if you can't tell, I'm completely panicked right now.
No, you're right. It's gorgeous.
Is that white with just a touch of redness? Are you putting on
now? Yeah, I'm just lightening my color a little bit. Only using three colors, so, you know, a lot of times it's not, you know, the value is the most important thing, the color is not. So I'm just lightening up a little bit. If you can't get the color right, get the value right, but with this limited palette, chances are, if you stay within the pinks in the middle and the yellows in the top and the blues in the bottom, you're gonna do okay without really knowing what you're doing. And that's how I like to teach. So you don't have to understand what I'm teaching you. If you just do it, you're gonna end up with pretty good results. So that's like having the map. You know, you're not going to have the nose too long, and having the right colors, you only have a few to choose from, so you can't go way out of bounds. So it's really the best way of learning how to paint, because I'm giving you limited things to do wrong, whether you understand it or not. And so much of what I've done, I mean, I started painting when I was 17, so I was an obedient student. Everything my teacher said was gospel to me. So I didn't have to, you know, I wasn't stubborn. Everything was gospel. But I didn't understand it. I just did it. And I ended up with really good results. And then when I got out of school, basically the Boston way of learning how to paint is to learn how to see without words. And then when I got out of my atelier, I met somebody who knew every rule in the book, and I'm like, well, geez, they didn't teach me any of that. I thought I learned nothing. So then the next 10 years was my quest of learning how to learn the rules. And the rules are basically there to help you when you're in trouble. And you don't necessarily need to know the rules. So then with wisdom and age and experience, I learned that the way that the Boston School taught me how to paint was more valuable. But as a teacher, the rules helped me to teach better. Mm-hmm. And teaching actually made me a better artist, because then you have to articulate everything for the student. So there's just so much to it. There really, really is so much to it. And of course, I paint every day, which is so beneficial. Because I don't forget what I did right and wrong the day before. And hopefully that feeds into what I'm doing that day. So, like, if you look around this room, like this painting here that's in the middle of the sunset, that day and this is what I love to do in the summer, I like to take a picnic, and I'll go and I'll paint like 3 or 4 paintings in a day. So the painting that's on the wall next to the door is the first one that I did. And then the second one that I did was in the last show that you had, with the group show. And then the third painting I did is this one here. And then I took that painting and I made it into a larger one. And then there's another painting, right next to it, of the beach scene with the people laying on the beach. I did that one. And then the one above it was like the next one. There was one in between that, and then was the moonscape. So all those paintings are one day's of work. Because you only have 3 hours before the scene changes completely. And if you're an artist, a working artist, you know, people work 9 to 5. So artists basically need to do that. And that's basically what the atelier taught you to do, is to work from 9 to 5, not wait for that inspiration to strike. So in the summertime, I like to get, you know, when the weather is great, it's the easiest. But I've been out there in 20 degrees weather too, and it's so much nicer to be out in that weather. So right now, because I took a little break and I'm turning around and looking this, I immediately see a few things that I can fix. Like her nose is just a little bit too dark over here. So breaks are important too. You have to learn how to take breaks. You have to use those tools, putting the hand over your eye, using the mirror. All those things are just vital with painting the portrait. Otherwise, you're going to paint what you know. And that's, you've got to learn how to paint what you see. And it's the last, sometimes it's the last 10 minutes that you really knock it home, if you stay in discipline. Because, you know, at first you're tackling big problems. Now you're tackling small problems, which are harder to see because you're tired. So the mirror is so important. So you can see what I'm doing. I'm not making any huge changes, just tiny changes. Lots of tiny changes. Thank you. And a lot of times, you know, what I like to do is to get that freshness at first and then finish it a day or two later when I'm fresh as well. And that's the thing about painting. You want to be, it's so hard. You really have to be at your best too. And of course, today I had a show opening. I taught yesterday afternoon. Then I helped my daughter move her heavy furniture in the afternoon. Then I had a show last night. So I'm a little tired today, to say the least.
So she found an apartment?
She did, yeah. Moved. She's moving in right now. Oh, we're so close. So, you know, you really want to think about the thickness. When at the end, you can stop putting in thick paint because you don't have to go over it. But you don't want to put that thick paint down too soon because you can't fix thick paint. You can only either make it thicker or wipe it off. And that's where your Bounty paper towel comes in handy, or your palette knife, a good quality palette knife. Now, another thing that I love to do that's very, very, again, vital as a portrait artist is to stand back, but I don't really have that option today. That's where the mirror really is so important. At the end, I always say I get you your exercise in as well as your painting, because it takes so much moving around, standing back and forth, so you can compare nicely. Well, I'm going to give her a quick 5-minute break, and then I'm going to come in at the end, so that way I can actually stand back a little bit. But what I'd like you to do is to come and look at this closely. So come right up and look at this to kind of see what I'm talking about. And then hopefully I'll knock it home. Now remember, her hair on this side has to be lighter than the hair on this side because it's farther away from the light. A lot of times, you know, if a person is blonde or have white hair, people paint the color of the hair rather than the way the light is hitting that hair. So again, a lot of the stuff, even after you've been an experienced painter, you still have to challenge yourself to do more. And that means being willing to make mistakes and ruin your painting, because that, you know, it's those happy mistakes that are the magical ones. So you have to be willing at all times to take those chances. So what I like to do when I'm not pressed for time is when I paint, in the last half hour of my painting, I always clean my palette and make sure I have enough paint out. So even if I have 5 minutes left and I run out of paint, I put more out. Really, really important thing to do. Because if you're working on a dirty palette, you're going to make dirty paint. So you always want to clean your palette. And if you get in the habit of doing it, then you won't have to think of it. You just do it. I actually gave her more here. And sometimes, you know, I used to throw away my crappy brushes, but sometimes having a brush that's a little bit frayed or whatever gives you a nice texture. So I do have a variety. So you get to think in the lips, one half of the lip is going to be darker than the other. On the top and on the bottom. Oh, we're so close. Oh, 5 minutes past one. Two, I mean. Going into my 3 hour mode here. We're almost there. Like I said, I like to paint, I'd like to give myself 3 hours. So doing this in 2 hours is, you know, difficult. So what I'll do is, when I paint and I know I'm not gonna finish, what I like to do is get the colors right, because the camera doesn't get the colors or the values right. So if you get that right here, you can just finish up the small details when you get some rest and finish the painting. So all the important stuff really is here.
So what do you see in the picture then when you take a picture to finish a painting? What is it you see later?
Well, it's just you see it with a fresh eye. Sometimes there's a lot to do and sometimes there's a little to do. Like for me, time is the commodity. I know I can make this look exactly like her if I have enough time. I just don't have the time. And then I do have an appointment afterwards. Otherwise, if she was willing and I was willing, we could sit here all day long. But unfortunately.
When you do the commissions, like of the judges and so forth, how long do those take?
That's a different thing. What I do with the judges is I take my own photographs. So I'll take like 400 photographs, and then I'll go through the photographs with the judges and ask them, you know, what do they like. And working from photos is way more difficult than working from life. That's 100 times more difficult. So I prefer, because everything is right in front of you when you work in life. The camera lies. It does, you know, there's a lot. It flattens your shadows. It gets the light wrong. But you know, with experience, you can work from photos, and I'm not as, I would look down on people who worked on photos for a long time, and now I don't do that anymore, because I have the experience to work from them. There's just some occasions that you can't, do anything else than work from a photo. But I work from life so much that I know what I'm doing. I know how the camera lies. A lot of times you can tell a person work from a photo because their hands might be way too big because the camera doesn't see the perspective. And they'll draw it verbatim of the photograph. So you can almost see like what looks finished and what doesn't, by the way that I work. Because I love the eyes, I'm gonna spend more time there, but slowly working my way down, you can see what's unfinished. Because I've been spending so much time not working all the way around my painting like I should have. But we're close. The trick is, when you finish, is that the whole painting should look at the same level of finish. So that's what I'm trying to do right now. I know what I need to do to finish it, but I want the painting at this point to look at the same level of finish. And then I'll go home and finish the rest of that.
Is that true whether you're doing that?
Yeah, you want the painting to have, you know, I mean, if it's unfinished looking, you want everything to be the same unfinished amount of look to it as well. I know that's hard to explain, but Right. And a painting doesn't have to look perfectly representational. Like somebody just recently put an artist, I won't say who it was, up on their Facebook, and I'm like, I don't get it. What do you love about this painting? I don't get it. The head is too small. It was poorly drawn. It was uninteresting. There was no color. Like, why do you love this artist so much? What you want to achieve with any painting, whether it's well drawn or not, is you want it to tell a story. You want there to be some emotional context to that painting. It doesn't have to be perfectly drawn. It can be abstract. But you want it to tell a story either with your brush strokes, your colors, the composition, or the subject matter. But these paintings just had nothing to them. And I had, not only was this artist crazy about it, but another artist that I deeply admire was crazy about this artist. And I'm like, I don't get it. Please just explain to me what it is about this artist that you love. Because I just thought it was like worse than child scribble. I just didn't like it at all. And then it gets me mad because it's such a crappy painting and people are admiring it. Like, it just doesn't make sense. I shouldn't say crappy because people love it, so. But I just don't get it, you know? And then when you see how hard it is to paint something well, and you know how much time it takes to be a great artist, and then you see something like that admired, it just...
Have you ever seen the painting not on a picture, but actually in person? Could it be maybe different in person?
Maybe, I don't know. I just, you know, there's a lot of artwork that's out there that people admire, and I just don't understand. Like, why? Why do you love this painting? There's no drawing ability in there. There's no life in there. I mean, I like certain abstract paintings, but this artist just... And I saw a lot of it, and none of it impressed me. Almost. Look at that smile. A little bit more. So close. And this is where my eyesight gets in the way. Looks a little like the Mona Lisa up there. Something about, as John Singer Sargent said, there's something always wrong about the mouth, right? Now, the nice thing about using the map is when you get in trouble, you can go back to it and double check. Are the eyes in the middle of the head? Yes. Are the nose in the middle of the eyes and the chin? Yes. You know, so those are ways to be able to go back and ask yourself, is it right or wrong? And the mirror is priceless. If you don't have a mirror, because you get tired. You need to have that fresh eye. So remember, DianePMiller.com. If you need anything, Kate will help you. You can have, if you love the painting but you don't like the size, I can redo it in any size you like. And we take commissions. Lunchtime. Now, another thing you have to remember to do is to get work, don't forget the neck. And you can see, just by fixing the neck, I fixed her face. I resolved something. I remember painting a woman one time with a very strong jaw, and I was so worried about making it look bad that I spent all my time on the jaw, and what I needed to do was to go into her shoulder and neck. And once I did that, I was done. It was great. So I think this painting all looks like it's at the same level of finish right now, so I'm going to relieve you of your chore and finish this at home. And hopefully you like it. So you're all set.